Hi friends, welcome to Cracko's video series. In this lecture, we'll be looking at the right approach to solving reading comprehension. Reading comprehension forms 70% of CAT verbal. It is the most important topic in CAT. Therefore, there's no escaping it. One needs to practice reading comprehension to be able to ace it. But the first step to solving reading comprehension properly is to read the passage properly. Therefore, one needs to carefully study the approach to solving reading comprehension. In this video lecture, we'll identify what is the right approach to solving reading comprehension. With the help of two RCs that came in the recent CAT, we'll be solving how to approach the RC, how to read the passage, and how to identify the main point of the passage. So let's begin. Let's take a look at the first RC. This RC came in CAT 2017. The RC is about humans' ability to make maps. Let's take a look at each paragraph of the RC. So this is the first paragraph of the RC. It basically says that most species are able to make cognitive maps of our surroundings. Humans are unique in their ability to communicate this understanding to each other. It also says that we have been doing this for thousands of years. So what is this paragraph basically saying? This paragraph is saying that most species are able to form maps of their surroundings. Humans are unique in their ability to communicate these maps to each other. Humans have been communicating maps to each other for thousands of years. Essentially, map making as a human trait has existed for thousands of years. Then let's come to the next paragraph. This paragraph says that despite the long history of map making, North has been placed at the top consistently only for a few hundred years. In fact, for most of the period of human history, North has not been placed at the top. So this is the main point of the paragraph, that though humans have been making maps for thousands of years, North has been placed at the top for only a few hundred years. It had not been placed at the top earlier for few reasons, like the ones that have been stated in the paragraph. Now let's take a look at the next paragraph. In this paragraph, the author says that early Chinese maps seem to buck the trend. That is the trend that the author mentioned, that North had not been placed at the top. In this case, the author says that Chinese maps placed the North at the top, not because of any reason that the magnetic compasses pointed to the North, or because they wanted the direction was auspicious or anything of that sort. In fact, the Chinese did not like the direction North, but they placed North at the top to pay respect to the emperor. Therefore, in this paragraph, the author is slightly countering the argument presented in the previous paragraph, but it is essentially a counterexample. Here, the author is slightly countering the main point of the previous paragraph, but saying that this is an exception, but it does not necessarily disprove the main point of the previous paragraph. Now, let's move on to the next paragraph. In this paragraph, the author has provided several examples of what different cultures put which direction on the top. So essentially, he is trying to say from this paragraph that cultures put that direction on the top according to what they valued. Therefore, different cultures ended up putting different directions at the top. Generally, they did not put North at the top. So now let's go on to the next paragraph. In this paragraph, the author asks the question, so when did people start putting North at the top? He gives a possible explanation by saying that it could be the European explorers like Columbus and Magellan. But then he refutes this by saying that Columbus did not think of the world as not being at the top. He thought of it as East being at the top. Therefore, through this paragraph, the author is saying that even the early European explorers did not think of North at the top. Therefore, even those guys did not place North at the top. Now let's try to take a holistic view of the entire passage. So let's begin by first recapping the main point of each paragraph. So the main point of the first paragraph was that map making has been done for thousands of years. But North has been placed at the top for only a few centuries because North was considered not to be a favorable direction. So North was not placed at the top. Because it was an unfavorable direction. Then
The author gives the counter example of the Chinese maps. But he says even this shows that North was not considered positive. It was just out of respect for the emperor. Now, the fourth paragraph basically gave different examples where different directions were put at the top, but rarely North was put at the top. And the fifth paragraph basically says that the explanation that the European explorers put North at the top is also wrong. So basically, what is the author trying to say through the passage? The main point of the passage is that North was not placed at the top for thousands of years. In fact, other cultures put different directions at the top of the map because they valued those directions more. Basically, the antecedents of this trend of putting North at the top are not clear, and this trend is basically limited to only a few hundred years. So this is the main point of the passage. Now that we have understood the main point of the passage, let's move on to seeing the role of each paragraph in the passage. Now let us understand why each paragraph has been used in the passage. Let's take a look at the first two paragraphs. So in the first two paragraphs, we see that in the first paragraph, the author is setting the context. And in the second paragraph, the author has directly stated the main point of the paragraph. So essentially, the way that the author is going about this is, he sets the context by saying that map making is innate and it is very important to us. But in spite of the thousands of years that we have been making maps, we have not been putting North at the top. So the direction of flow of the passage is context, main point till now. Now let's take a look at the next two paragraphs. In these two paragraphs, the author first offers a counter example. The Chinese seem to buck this trend. Therefore, this is a counterexample. But he then refutes this counterexample by saying that even they didn't consider North to be auspicious or favorable. They put North at the top despite having reservations about that direction. So essentially, the third paragraph is a counterexample. Then the fourth paragraph are positive examples to make the point. So they are essentially supporting examples. So the flow till now is context, main point, counterexample, supporting examples. Now let's take a look at the last paragraph. So the last paragraph is kind of concluding it. He is here negating a popularly held belief that it could be attributed to the European explorers. But the author does not offer a concrete conclusion as such. He leaves the discussion open-ended. He just says that the antecedents of this trend are not clear, but this trend of putting North at the top is very recent. Now that we've identified the main point of each paragraph, the main point of the passage, and the role played by each paragraph in the passage, we can draw the chain of thought. So let's take a look at the chain of thought. So basically, the chain of thought has been like this. There is the context, then there is the main point, then there is a counter example, then there is supporting examples, and then he leaves the discussion open-ended by negating one explanation of it. So through this passage, the author is basically saying that North being placed at the top is a recent trend. And he has left the conclusion open-ended by saying that the explanation that this could possibly be because of early European explorers is a incorrect explanation. He has in fact pointed out several examples where North was not placed at the top. Now that we have understood all of these aspects of the passage, let's take a look at an inference-based question on this passage. So let's take a look at this question. So the question basically asks, which of the following best describes what the passage is trying to do? So we know what the passage has been trying to do. It has been trying to make the point that North was not placed at the top for thousands of years while humans were making maps. This is in fact a recent trend. So essentially it is trying to make the point that the idea that North was placed at the top since humans have been making maps is a wrong one. Therefore, if we see the options, we can eliminate the wrong ones and we can find the right answer. It questions an explanation about how maps are designed. It does not do this. It offers a correction to an explanation which is widely held. But this is not, it doesn't just question it, it corrects a explanation. Therefore, option A is wrong. It corrects a misconception about the way maps are designed. This is very close to what the author has been doing throughout the passage. He is clearing a misconception. He is clearing the misconception that North was always placed at the top. He has provided several examples to show that North was not placed at the top. Let's see the third and fourth options. It critiques a methodology. Definitely not. It does not critique any methodology. We can straight away eliminate this option. Fourth is it explores some myths about maps. Firstly, it is correcting only one misconception, that is North was placed at the top. So myths or plural form is incorrect. Therefore, we can eliminate option D also. Therefore, the correct answer is option B. So if you identify the chain of thought, we identify the main point of the passage, and we identify the main point of each paragraph, we can quickly understand what the author is trying to do here. The author is trying to support this idea that not being placed at the top is a recent trend. It was not always so. Be very careful in identifying the main point of the passage. In this case, the main point came in the second paragraph. From then on, the author was just building the main point. To notice the main point, what you can see is that whenever the author says something like in fact, but, however, although, pay close attention to what the author is saying next. In most cases, that would be something which is very crucial to the passage. In this case, he used the words in fact and then stated the main point. Whenever he says in fact, he is trying to correct an already existing idea held by the reader. So many people thought that there is no misconception as such. He has not stated, okay, that North being placed at the top was a previously held idea. But when somebody uses the words in fact, it is in directly saying that there is an assumed idea in the minds of the reader that the author is trying to correct. So option B, as we can see, is the right answer. Now that we have understood how to read the paragraphs, how to read the passage, let's take a look at another RC. Now let's take a look at an RC from the afternoon slot. This RC is about creativity. So let's take a look at the first paragraph. The first paragraph says that creativity is innate and precious. He says that children, every child has it. So essentially saying that creativity is innate and precious. The author is proposing the idea that social contact fosters creativity. Creativity is a social process. The idea that creativity is an individual trait is the wrong one. Therefore, through this paragraph, the author is basically trying to introduce the main point of the passage by saying that creativity is a social process and not an individual process, and it cannot be nurtured in isolation. Now let's take a look at the next paragraph. In this paragraph, the author is providing supporting examples for what he has already given. He's saying that cities are the true fonts of creativity. So his main point is that social interaction is necessary for creativity. And what promotes social interaction? Social interaction is promoted in socially dense areas like cities. Therefore, cities have characteristics that allow for creative sparks, and it also has the infrastructure to put those sparks into execution. Therefore, this is basically supporting what he has given in the previous paragraph. Now let's take a look at the next paragraph. Now he comes to the topic of what staunches creativity. So he is basically saying that what staunches creativity is like bureaucracy, institutions like schools, and anything that is regimented, standardized and stultifying. So in this paragraph, the author is basically identifying things that kind of hinder creativity. So till now he has identified what is good for creativity and what is bad for creativity. Now let's move on to the next slide. Now let's take a look at what he's saying in the next paragraph. In the next paragraph, he cites a study which shows that humans were able to think fewer and fewer out of the box solutions as they grew older. So through this paragraph, he's indirectly pointing a finger at schooling system, where he says that children were smarter at thinking of out-of-box solutions than adults. So he's clearly pointing that there is something wrong with the way we are teaching students. In this paragraph, the author is basically quoting the urbanist Jane Jacobs, where she says that all cities have the potential to be creative, but some cities are hindered because of bad leaders and bad organizations. These she calls as squelchers. So essentially, she is now pointing finger at bad organizations and bad leaders for being a reason why creativity is not being promoted. Now let's take a look at the next paragraph. In this paragraph also, the author discusses what is hindering creativity. He points to the fact that almost 2/3 of the US population is working in low wages jobs which do not use their creativity. Here they do not work with their minds, so they do not have to use their creativity. So in such cases, creativity is subjugated, ignored or wasted. So basically, through this paragraph, the author is blaming bad jobs for hindering creativity. Now let's take a look at the last paragraph. The last paragraph says that creativity itself is not in danger. There is creativity all around us. But to be a truly creative society, we need to do more. We are doing a lot of things that actually hinder creativity. Now that we have understood the main point of each paragraph, let's try to identify the main point of the passage. So let's recap the main points of each paragraph. So the main point of each paragraph, the main point of the first paragraph was that creativity is a social process. The main point of the second paragraph was that creativity is promoted in socially dense areas like cities. Then he moves on to what actually hinders creativity. In the third paragraph, the author says that bad systems such as schools or organizations and bureaucracy hinder creativity. Then he cites an example. So this is basically a study which says that schooling system is in fact reducing creativity among children. So this is a supporting example or supporting study. Now he then comes on to the explanation given by Jane Jacobs, who says that bad leaders and bad organizations are the difference between some cities being creative while the others are not. So essentially, this paragraph is about the role played by leaders and organizations in hindering creativity. Now let's come to the next paragraph. In the next paragraph, the author says that bad jobs which do not allow their workers to employ their minds, or mindless jobs essentially, are the ones that are wasting the creativity of 2/3 of the population. So this is wasting creativity. Now the last paragraph is essentially conclusion, which basically says that we need to do more to foster creativity. Now that we've understood the different main points of each of the paragraphs, let's try to identify what is the main point of the passage. The main point of that passage is basically that the author is arguing that we need to do more to build creative societies. His idea of how a society can be more creative is through encouraging social interaction. Also, he blames bad organization, bad schooling systems, bad jobs and bad leaders for hindering creativity. So essentially through this passage, the author is arguing what we need to do to foster a more creative society. He wants more social interaction and less bureaucracy. Now that we have understood the main point of the passage, let's take a look at what role each paragraph is playing in the passage. Now, the first two paragraphs, we see that in the first paragraph itself, the author proposes the main idea. This is the main idea of the passage. Everything that he has said since is basically building on this idea. This is the author's belief. This passage is persuasive in nature. He hasn't analyzed it. He hasn't looked at it objectively. The author is basically trying to convince you that this is how we should build a creative society. So he has upfront stated the main point of the passage. He has not built much of context. He has not like looked at different arguments or nothing of that sort. He has told that this is how you should foster creativity. The second paragraph plays the role of a supporting argument. He identifies what is good for creativity. This argument basically bolsters his point that social interaction is good. So social interaction is more in cities, so cities are good for creativity. Now let's take a look at the third and fourth paragraph. From the third paragraph, he has identified what staunches creativity. So these are the things that are bad for creativity. So schools and organizations are bad for creativity. Bureaucracy is bad for creativity. In the fourth paragraph, he explicitly blames the schooling system for staunching creativity. In the fifth paragraph, he blames bad leaders, bad institutions for staunching creativity. Now, in the next paragraph, he blames bad jobs, jobs that do not require people to think. These are bad for creativity because they do not allow the workers to use their creativity. Now, the last paragraph, he basically sums up by saying that we need to do more to be a creative society. We need to do more in terms of allowing social interaction and to prevent hindrance of creativity by bad jobs, bad schools, bad organizations. So essentially, this is his idea of how a society can be more creative. He has been very upfront. It's been like main point, supporting argument, supporting argument, supporting argument. He hasn't really been like indirect in the passage at all. This passage is essentially, he has like put his argument up front and then just went on bolstering it with examples. So let's take a look at the chain of thought as such. So the chain of thought is very simple. The chain of thought is basically main point, bunch of supporting arguments, and conclusion. Now that we have identified the main theme of the passage, the chain of thought, what role each paragraph plays in the passage, we can answer inference-based questions on this passage. So let's take a look at this inference-based question. What is the central idea of this passage? These are the options. If we see the options, we can directly eliminate the option B. Creativity and ideas are gradually declining in the society. This is not the main point of the passage. The passage is all about promoting the author's idea about how the society can be more creative. He in fact is pretty positive about it. He says that creativity is all around us. So he'll definitely not say this. The option C is that creativity divide is widening in society along the socioeconomic trends. This is not the main point of the passage. We know that that paragraph was just a supporting example. It was not the main point. The main point was there in the first paragraph itself. So this is also wrong. Option 4 is more people should work in jobs that engage their creative faculties. Again, this is not the main point of the paragraph. This was just used in their supporting example. So supporting example is very different from the main point of the paragraph. The supporting example bolster the main point, but essentially it's like all of those supporting examples together work towards building the main point. If we see this supporting example of bad jobs, the other supporting example of bad organization and bad leaders does not support this one. These are two different points as such, but they together support the point that creativity is a social process, and our current way of building creativity, that is through these schools and organization, is a bad one. So all of these are actually supporting this main point, which was introduced in the first paragraph. Therefore, from the first paragraph itself, we can say that the main point or the central idea of the passage is that creativity is a social process. So social interaction is necessary to nurture creativity. This is the central idea of the passage. As we can see from this passage, identifying the role played by each paragraph is very important in understanding what is the main point of the passage. It is very important in identifying that this is just a detail, this is just a supporting argument, this is not the main point of the passage. When you start going through passages in this way, where you identify, okay, this is the main point of the paragraph, this is the main point of the paragraph, this is the role this paragraph is playing in supporting the main point of the overall passage, then you will be able to quickly answer inference-based questions. So what I propose to you is that today go and look at each passage in this way. Read a lot of passages and try to identify the role played by each paragraph in that passage. Try to identify first the main point of the paragraph. Once you have identified the main point of the paragraph, identify the main point of the passage. Once you have identified main point of the passage, identify what role each paragraph is playing in the passage. Once you have done that, identify the chain of thought. Once you are able to do this, if you do this often enough in RC, you will be able to answer every inference-based question in RC. If this comes instinctively to you, you will be able to grasp any RC. This is essentially the right approach to solving reading comprehension. So I would urge all students to go back and solve RCs using this approach. Thank you for tuning in.